Okay, good afternoon, everyone. And Robin, I have this on. We're good? Okay. Welcome to our first inaugural International Steenbach Lectureship. So as you know, for many years now, the Biochemistry Colloquium's flagship lectureship is in honor of Harry Steenbach. And this year we're adding, for the first time, an international version of the Steenbach Lecture. So the Steenbach Lectureship, of course, is named after Harry Steenbach, who was a famous scientist and here at UW-Madison. In fact, Harry grew up in Madison, grew up in Wisconsin, and spent most of his education here in Madison. And fittingly, for today's speaker, the last place Harry was before returning to Madison to finish his PhD and really spend the rest of his career was in Germany. It was in Berlin. So Harry was known for, made many seminal scientific discoveries and many contributions to the university, but none more noteworthy perhaps than his contributions to vitamin D fortification. So Harry was instrumental in getting a rat colony here at the university and discovered that it was the radiation, not of the animals themselves, but the food they ate, was sufficient to cure rickets. It led to the activation of vitamin D. And Harry used then $300 of his own money to patent his invention, and was later offered in the 20s $1 million from the Quaker Oats Company for the rights to that patent, which he turned down because he believed that the university should really be the beneficiary of his work. So along with eight other Wisconsin alumni who each contributed $100, they started the Wisconsin Alumni Research Foundation, WARF. And in 27, WARF had its first licensing agreement to the Quaker Oats Company that uses technology to fortify their cereals with vitamin D. So I think it's pretty clear that Harry is someone worth honoring, and I am excited today to honor our speaker with a lectureship in his name. So Professor Thomas Langer received his PhD in 1993 from the University of Munich, in part through his work. He moved during his PhD and spent time at Memorial Sloan Kettering with friends Ulrich Hartl, who did pioneering work in protein folding and is now the managing director of the Max Planck Institute for Biochemistry. So Thomas's early work had to do with protein folding and chaperone-mediated protein folding. Then he moved back to Germany and joined the lab of Walter Neupert, where he did his postdoctoral work, and then was received a full professorship at the University of Cologne in the year 2000. So Thomas's work deals with mitochondrial proteases, everything about proteases, how they work biochemically, how they're regulated, and all in his work is quite eclectic in dealing with proteases, things like the control of mitochondrial fission and fusion, the membrane dynamics, lipid trafficking, many different aspects of mitochondrial function. It's really put him at the forefront of really a burgeoning and field of mitochondrial dynamics. And so I'm very excited today to introduce Thomas, and he'll be giving, of course, two lectures tomorrow, same time, same place, at 3:30. And before I introduce his first lectureship entitled Mitochondrial Proteases, Membrane Dynamics and Disease, I'll remind you that right after the lecture today, we'll have a reception outside running until 5:30. So please join me in welcoming Professor Thomas Langer.
So thank you very much, Dave, for this nice introduction and for bringing me here to Wisconsin. It's actually the first time that I'm here, and I have to say I'm truly impressed already. I'm very much honored to give the first international Steenbach lectureship. It's really a pleasure for me to be here. And I should say I really spent already a gorgeous day, the whole day over, talking with students and many faculty. And I just can say it's really a great place. And I'm really happy to be here. And I'm looking forward to even more of these talks. But before that, I will actually give you a first part of a glimpse on our work on mitochondria. And as Dave already said, we are interested in mitochondrial proteases in this organelle. And this organelle is not only beautiful, as shown here for primary hippocampal neurons, where these mitochondria are highlighted with GFP, forming this, showing that they form this reticulated and tubular network, these organelles are also very essential. And actually, as I'm aware that I'm talking, or many of you don't think of mitochondria each single day, which is maybe a mistake, but I thought I'd just remind all of you in the first slide that these organelles are really essential. So there is no proliferating cell without having mitochondria. No? And you will all immediately think that mitochondria are energy-producing organelles, and of course all cells need ATP, and you are absolutely right, but this is presumably not the reason why mitochondria are really essential for those cells, because there are cells, just think of Baker's yeast, that can survive without respiration in mitochondria, and this just shows you, but they still need mitochondria. And there are many other functions in mitochondria, and this is just a list of those, certainly not a comprehensive list, and just highlighting here that what is now recognized as the essential function of mitochondria is this synthesis of iron sulfur clusters, which takes in part in mitochondria. So mitochondria are really essential for cell survival, but there was really a boost in the last 10 years, I think, in the research in mitochondria, because it was recognized that these organelles are not isolated organelles that, as you may know, are derived from bacterial ancestors, but that these organelles are really deeply integrated in cell physiology. And mitochondria are now much more sort of kind of signaling platforms in a cell, which are integrated in major cellular signaling pathways. And this interconnection of mitochondria with cell physiology really has boosted mitochondrial research and the interest in mitochondria as an essential cellular organelle over recent years. Now, although, or maybe even though, mitochondria are essential organelles, their biogenesis is extremely complicated, and it is for the cell really a challenge to preserve mitochondrial activity, which is essential for cell survival. And this is in part because mitochondria have their own genome, and although the coding capacity is limited, this genome encodes a subset of essential respiratory chain subunits that have to assemble with nuclear-encoded respiratory chain subunits into functional respiratory complexes. And you can imagine that if there's any imbalance in this expression from these two different cellular genomes, that there is a problem in the mitochondria and kind of protein stress. As you will hear later in more detail, mitochondria are highly dynamic. They form this tubular network that I have shown you before, and they're constantly rearranged, but they must preserve their functional integrity during these processes. Just think of the proton gradient that is built up across the inner membrane that must be maintained during this membrane rearrangement by fusion and fission. And of course, mitochondria are the site of respiration, and a byproduct of this respiration are so-called reactive oxygen species, which are, of course, damaging agents that react with protein, lipids, and DNA in the nearest neighborhood, and this is the site of production in mitochondria, and in this sense can also cause damage and oxidative stress. But now it's also becoming more and more clear that this ROS, rather than only acting as a damaging agent, also has important signaling functions. Now, but this just should highlight that it's really a challenge to preserve mitochondrial integrity and function. And in fact, if you have a dysfunction of mitochondria, this is associated with many diseases caused by mutations in mitochondrial genes, but also secondarily affecting many often neurodegenerative diseases, or the pathology of these diseases. And there's a decline of mitochondrial activities during the aging process, and there's a lot of debate about it, what the contribution of this dysfunction of mitochondria really is directly to this aging process. Now, this all should just tell you that it's very important for a cell to preserve mitochondrial activities and function, to specifically recognize mitochondrial damage and remove this damage from the cell just to ensure cell survival. Now, therefore, it's not really, considering the importance of mitochondria, maybe it's not really surprising that there's a really complex network of quality control mechanisms in place that basically just fulfill this function. And a key component of this quality control system are proteases that reside within mitochondria. So these are just regular proteases that you know, and mitochondria have a whole complement and have basically the ability to completely degrade proteins down to the amino acid level. So the oligopeptidases, ATP-dependent proteases. Now, originally, proteases were recognized in mitochondria as simply as processing peptidases that chop off mitochondrial targeting sequences of nuclear-encoded proteins functions and therefore mediate their maturation and ensure their functional activity. So this is the classical function. But it became clear later that there are a whole complement of different proteases present in mitochondria. And many of them are ATP dependent, so they utilize ATP for degrading proteins. And they were originally considered mainly as quality control proteases to do exactly what I just described to you: recognize damaged proteins and remove them, degrade them to prevent their accumulation and possibly deleterious effects. But, and this is actually also the time when we started to get interested in these proteases, but it turns out over the years that these proteases, in addition, or maybe even to say much more than having a quality control function, they have important regulatory functions during mitochondrial biogenesis. So the proteases recognize specific proteins of regulatory with a regulatory function and preserve in this way both the biogenesis and the maintenance of mitochondrial activities. And therefore, it's now actually of broad interest in the field to understand what really the function of these proteases is, not least because there are many, many diseases associated with these proteases in mitochondria. Actually, with any, almost any of the proteases, a disease has been associated with now in recent years. Now, these regulatory functions really affect various aspects of mitochondrial biogenesis and function. And this may be a bit busy slide here. You see that all these functions include the biogenesis of mitochondria, the synthesis of proteins within mitochondria, ribosome assembly, mitochondrial dynamics, quality control, like mitophagy and apoptosis, and so on and so forth. Also the phospholipid metabolism, and so on and so forth. Now, my lab has a long-lasting interest in mitochondrial proteases and basically looking for substrates and proteases regulated by these enzymes in mitochondria. We actually, as Dave pointed out, touched upon many different aspects of mitochondrial biology. And what I do now in these two talks today and tomorrow is basically introduce you to two of these processes that are regulated by proteases and describe a bit what we have done in these areas. And one, today's lecture will be on the regulation of mitochondrial dynamics by proteases. And tomorrow I will talk more about phospholipid metabolism in mitochondria and the trafficking of lipids within mitochondria. And we look at these processes in general using yeast, cell culture, and mouse models, and try to bridge actually our understanding from a more biochemical analysis to really more to study these processes in a more physiological context. And today I will have a more physiological talk, and tomorrow I will talk more about the biochemical analysis of these processes. Now, mitochondrial dynamics. I mentioned already mitochondria are highly dynamic organelles. They constantly fuse and divide. And this determines the topology of mitochondria in a cell. It can be very different in different cell types, in different tissues. You may know this from any textbook. If you look at mitochondria, they can look quite different. You know, this is a fibroblast. You see, again, this reticulated network of mitochondria that is maintained by these fusion and fission events. Now, these fusion and fission events have many functions to preserve, are very important to preserve mitochondrial activity. The fusion is usually, which results in tubulation of mitochondria, is considered as a pro-survival mechanism. It pushes mitochondrial activities, preserves mitochondrial integrity, maybe also to preserve contact, allow contact mixing between different mitochondria in a cell. Whereas the fission is associated with a mitochondrial quality control. A fragmentation of the mitochondrial network, for instance, allows the autophagic removal of damaged mitochondria. You separate them from a tubular network and then can selectively remove damage from these organelles or damaged parts of this organelle. And if it comes to the worst and the cell cannot fix the problem anymore, mitochondria, the outer membrane is ruptured and pro-apoptotic proteins like cytochrome C are released from the intermembrane space, triggering cell death. And if you think this is maybe the final quality control mechanism, if you want. Now, this fusion and fission, therefore, is very important for this maintenance of mitochondrial quality control. Now, the reason why I'm actually highlighting this is because the fragmentation of mitochondria is observed under many also pathologic conditions. And keep in mind, fragmentation can be brought about by both, either by inhibiting fusion, in this way ongoing fission event will result in fragmentation, or you can stimulate fission, and this will override the fusion event, and it will, in both cases, result in mitochondrial fragmentation. So this is all a balance between, but the fragmentation of the mitochondrial network is really observed in many pathologic conditions. And it is becoming, and this actually also fostered a lot of research in mitochondria because people notice, oh, something happens with the mitochondria under these cells. What I will tell you today, or will try to convince you today, that this is a very general stress response, how mitochondria basically adapt to cellular stress under various conditions, that is actually under control of proteases that reside within mitochondria and that affect the balance between fusion and fission. Now, there's a whole set of proteases, but the two proteases I'm focusing on are these two guys here, and both proteases that reside in the mitochondrial inner membrane. One is termed YME1, and the other one is OMA1. And I think I have another one. No, actually, no. So YME1 is an ATP-dependent protease, an ATP-dependent metalloprotease, forms hexameric ring complexes, and is a classical quality control enzyme. And OMA1, as you will see later, is a stress-activated metallopeptidase also in the inner membrane. Now, these two proteases actually control a central player of the mitochondrial fusion machinery, and this is the OPA1. Now, fusion and fission of mitochondria is mediated by dynamine-like GTPases, both acting on the outer membrane and at the inner membrane. And this is a central player of the fusion machinery in the inner membrane, and it's termed OPA1. Because mutation in this dynamine actually are the most frequent case of inherited blindness in human. And this is how it was also discovered. And this is a rather complex molecule because there are actually 8 different splice variants that are expressed in a tissue-specific manner. And we can come back to this later if you want, what maybe the purpose of this is. And even more, there are not only the splice variants, but they also undergo proteolytic processing. And for the sake of this talk, it's actually sufficient to memorize that this proteolytic processing is really essential to preserve mitochondrial morphology. So, and therefore, this fostered a lot of interest to understand how this, what are really the proteases that are mediating this cleavage event and how are they regulated. And there was a lot of, I can tell you, discussion about it, what the proteases are. But I think this is a bit settled now, because there are these two proteases that I mentioned already, the OMA1 and YME1, were shown to cleave OPA1 at 2 distinct sites. So there are specific sites that are close to each other where these proteases cleave OPA1, converting it into long forms into short ones. Now, this looks a bit complicated here, but in fact, it is not so complicated once you distinguish long and short forms. And there are different sites. So if you delete OMA1 here, then you basically abolish cleavage at site 1. And this form C and E disappear. If you cleave the second protease, which is YME1, then you selectively lose the cleavage product of cleavage at site 2. And if you combine, and this is most important for what I'm going to say next, you basically lose any processing. So these experiments that were actually done by Ruchika Anand and Tim Wei in the lab actually demonstrated, I think, unambiguously that these are the two proteases that really cleave this dynamine-like GTPase. That was by itself interesting to us, but in particular it was interested that this now allowed us for the first time to really look what is the function of this processing. It was understood that really you need this processing somehow to preserve morphology, but it was really unclear how this is brought about and what the function of this processing is. So therefore, we looked at these cells, and these were knockout cells that we derived from respective animals. Then we had really a surprise, and I don't want to go into showing you any data here. Just want to say, so we looked at this protease. There was no processing of OPA1, and the mitochondria looked completely fine. So there is mitochondrial fusion is ongoing. The ultrastructure of mitochondria, they form this peculiar cristae, was completely normal. And also the apoptotic resistance, so the resistance to release cytochrome C from these cells, was completely normal. So that was really a surprise, almost a shock to us, I have to say, because we were also assuming that this is really important for the for the maintenance of mitochondrial morphology. Now, further experiments then actually confirmed that really this long unprocessed form of OPA1 is sufficient to mediate fusion. And what OPA1 processing is doing, it limits the accumulation of the fusion form. And even more, we think, but here I think we are not absolute, it's not the last word, it's not said, that the short form of OPA1 is instead associated with the fission process. So what the proteases do by cleaving at these specific sites, they basically cleave long OPA1 forms, which is the fusion active form, limit the accumulation of the fusion active form, and at the same time accumulate a short version that is associated with the fission. So they basically, in both cases, they drive the balance of fusion and fission in such a way that they stimulate the fragmentation of the mitochondrial network. So this is basically the idea. So they balance fusion and fission. And the special thing is, why do we need two proteases? We think that these proteases respond to different input signals. So the proteases are differentially regulated. The product is not. We think that the short form of that are generated by these proteases are functionally, as far as we can tell now, up to now, completely equivalent. The differences only come from differences in the cleavage specificity. They differ by a few amino acids, but they all both proteases convert long forms into short forms, and by that shift the balance to mitochondrial fragmentation. Yeah? That's maybe the first important take-home message for today. Now, to which signals do these proteases respond then? Now, we see, as I will show you in a minute, OMA1 is a typical stress-activated peptidase and responds to different types of stress, whereas YME1 seems to be regulated, and this is by far less clear, by different metabolic cues. And the principle is therefore, by differential expression of these two proteases in different tissues, by differential expression of these two different 8-splice variants, which differ in their content of the proteolytic sites, you can basically adjust any level of long versus short form in any tissue that you want to have. So it's basically a perfect system to trim and optimize this, or adapt this balance between fusion and fission to any physiological condition you may think of. So therefore, I think it's a very cute system to really regulate this balance between fusion and fission. Now, I mentioned OMA1 is a stress-activated peptidase. This is basically just the same. When you activate then this OMA1, you basically have this shift this to the fission, and you have a fragmented mitochondrial network. Now, OMA1 is a stress-activated peptidase, and this is just a panel of different conditions that Philip Lampe, actually at that time a master student in the lab, did during this thesis, where he basically treated isolates, so in this case these are MEFs, with different stress conditions, and I admit these are extreme stress conditions. For instance, depolarization of mitochondria. Mitochondria will die, actually, when they are depolarized, but in a cell you can do it. It's also a reversible event, I should say. But then you basically trigger the conversion over time of the long forms into these short forms, and this is mediated by this OMA1 peptidase. And this you can actually do under various conditions. So you can do it, you know, under oxidative stress conditions, heat stress conditions. You can inhibit activities of respiratory chain complexes under hypoxic conditions. Under all these conditions, this peptidase is activated and cleaves these long forms of OPA1, limits fusion, and shifts the balance of fusion and fission to mitochondrial fragmentation. Okay, so this seems to be a very general stress-responsive pathway. Now, how this is regulated? One aspect that was actually, we were surprised when we started to look at the peptidase, what happens to the peptidase itself during stress conditions. And this is shown in this experiment that Michael Baker did in the lab, so where he basically expressed a tagged variant, but it doesn't matter, it's the same for the endogenous protein, and to look at it, at that time we didn't have a good antibody for it, and what he observed is that he did, when he applied stress, in this case it's depolarization, he did not only see this conversion of the long forms into the short forms, but he also saw this turnover of the OMA1 protein itself. So it turns out this is autocatalytic because he didn't see it in cells expressing only the proteolytically inactive variant, indicating that there's autocatalytic processing of, not only processing of OPA1, but also autocatalytic degradation of OMA1 under these conditions. So active stress conditions, like for instance depolarization of mitochondria, activate, we think, somehow OMA1 peptidase, and we would love to understand how. I'll come to that in a minute. This has two consequences. It induces the processing of OPA1, shifting the balance as described, but at the same time, it initiates its own degradation. And we think this makes a lot of sense, although it looks weird at the time, because it ensures the reversibility of the stress response. Otherwise, anything that activates a protease irreversibly would basically, there would be no way back until the lifetime of the protease. Huh? But in this case, because the protease basically limits its own lifetime, you basically ensure the reversibility of the stress response. And indeed, you can show in vitro that if you alleviate the stress after some time, the tubular network recovers, which is only possible because the protease is gone again. So therefore, we consider this as a kind of inbuilt timer in this regulatory, in this stress response. Now, we are of course interested to understand how this is activated, best on a structural level, but I was talking with some people already, it's really difficult to get it for these proteins, so we don't have it, but we made a very simple observation, actually, and that is we looked at our second model system that actually also expressed an OMA1 variant, but much to our surprise, we didn't see any turnover of OMA1, and there is also no stress-induced cleavage of the OPA1 homolog MGM1 in yeast. So this stress pathway does not seem to occur in yeast. So therefore, we thought we can exploit that to maybe learn a little bit more about how the stress response pathway is regulated, and we expressed in yeast cells lacking the yeast OMA1, the mouse OMA1. Huh? And basically, when we then treated those cells, or stressed those cells, then we basically saw autocatalytic turnover of this mouse protein. So the mammalian proteins have the intrinsic property to degrade themselves that the yeast proteins don't have. Huh? So there's apparently a difference between the yeast and the mammalian proteins. Now, of course, we looked at the sequence, and what becomes very apparent is a conserved protein family, metallopeptidase family, and we noticed then that, of course, the mouse one, also the human one, they have N and C terminal extensions when we compare them to the yeast one. So the yeast seem to have the core peptidase domain, but maybe the mammalian proteins attained additional domains that make them responsive to mitochondrial stress. And we therefore started to mutate these areas in the mouse proteins to really learn more about it. And I don't want to say much, that's a very busy slide here, but just maybe focus on that. There is a patch here of hydrophobic amino acid and charged amino acid that somehow attracted our attention. And it turns out when we mutate these positive charges, which are in this N-terminal region on the other side of the membrane, we basically can obtain a mutant that is still active, it still cleaves OPA1, we still see this OPA1 forms, but is barely responding to stress like depolarization or oxidative stress. So this actually indicated to us that this region is very important for the sensing of the stress. So we have a positive cluster in the amino terminal end that basically, I should put this figure here because here I can show it best, that basically in this part, which we think somehow senses the stress and activates this peptidase under stress conditions upon depolarization and basically allows increased processing of these OPA1. But this is about what we know, and we would very much like to understand what really is the signal that is sensed, whether it's really only the membrane potential or whether there are other things. Okay, good. So this is basically what I have told you so far. This OMA1 is a stress-activated peptidase. It cleaves L-OPA1, which is active in fusion, and in this case inhibits fusion, and it also, in this case, accumulates S-OPA1, which we think, I still put a question mark here, is activating fission, and in that case, OMA1 activation results in mitochondrial fragmentation. We have an N-terminal sensor domain that is important for this response, and after this response, OMA1 degrades itself, limiting, basically ensuring the reversibility of this response. Only if you have persistent mitochondrial stress, so if you have persistent stress, then this basically results in persistent mitochondrial fragmentation, and we think this fosters or renders the cells prone to cell death. So we have this fragmentation as an initial response, and if it is persistent, it results in cell death. Now this is all done in vitro, and cultured cells in vitro. And of course, we are very much interested to understand or basically prove the relevance of this stress-activated pathway also under in vivo conditions. And therefore, we moved into mouse. And this is actually the second part what I wanted to tell you today, our work where we looked at the role of this stress-activated pathway mediated by this stress-activated OMA1 peptidase in vivo. And to do that, we generated two mouse models for the OPA1 processing peptidase, and this was done by Tim Wei, who did most of the work that I'm going to tell you now, actually almost exclusively, and Michael Baker, who generated the OMA1 conditional knockout mouse for OMA1. Now, a knockout mouse for OMA1 has been described by Carlos Lopez Otin groups in Spain, and they observed that these mice are viable, so the complete knockout, a conventional knockout of these mice, and they observed a diet-induced obesity in these mice and an impaired thermogenesis. But otherwise, these mice are fine. In contrast, when we deleted the second OPA1 processing peptidase, these mice were caused an embryonic lethal phenotype. So we used, therefore we generated conditional knockouts, and we used different Cre driver lines. And in this case, and this is now really all the work, I should really highlight this of Tim, he used a Cre line that is specific for cardiomyocytes, and this will become later, more important later during my talk. And when we looked at these mice, the loss of this YME1 specifically in cardiomyocytes limited the lifespan of these mice. They all died, with about 1 year. This is just to show that there's a selective loss in cardiomyocytes. This was associated with body weight loss and so on and so forth in these mice. But of course, we wanted to look how does it affect the heart function, and therefore teamed up with the group of Boria Ibanez in Spain, who are cardiologists and are really specialists for doing the heart function. And they did, actually Tim went there also, they did this heart analysis, and basically what you see here, the echocardiograph of these mice. I was really happy to see that, because even me, being not a heart specialist, could immediately see that there's a phenotype. I should say this is now 18 weeks, so rather early in the mice, and the next is a progressive phenotype. Now when the mice, many of the mice are dying already, at 40 weeks you see that there's a more severe phenotype. So the heart function is severely impaired upon loss of YME1 in mitochondria, specifically in cardiomyocytes. Now, these mice, and I don't want to go too into much detail, show all characteristics of a dilated cardiomyopathy. So these mice show dilated cardiomyopathy. They have a reduced volume that is ejected from the left ventricle. They show signs of fibrosis, and we see the death of cardiomyocytes, and this death is a necrotic cell death. So various characteristics of dilated cardiomyopathy, including a typical shift in metabolism that is observed or has been observed in other mouse models for a mitochondrial dysfunction. And this is a shift in metabolism from the utilization of fatty acids to the glucose utilization. And this we could basically show by doing some PET CTs, where we basically see that in the YME1 knockout mice, there's a significantly increase in the glucose uptake in the heart. And we also see a reduced level of total cardiac acyl carnitines in these animals. So this all illustrates, and other experiments I don't show you, that there's a shift from the utilization of lipids to glucose. So we have an increased glucose uptake in the mice, and as I said, this is a really typical sign of cardiomyopathies that are associated with a dysfunction of mitochondria. Now, what is the reason for that? Of course, we looked at a mitochondrial proteins. Everyone, I'm sure most of you, will immediately think, of course, we'll knock out a mitochondrial protein, ATP production is impaired, and the muscle doesn't work, and we have a heart failure. Of course, we also thought that, but it's clearly not the case. We looked here at the enzymatic activities of the respiratory chain complexes, of oxygen consumption in the mice, and there was no phenotype whatsoever. If anything, we see a slightly improved activity of some respiratory chain complexes that we still try to understand. But the message here is now there is no impairment of respiratory activities in these mice, no reduced ATP production. So it's the failing heart in this mouse model is definitely not caused by an energy crisis in these muscles. So what can be the reason? I mean, we started to work on this because we wanted to understand the function of YME1 as an OPA1 processing peptidase. Of course, we looked at mitochondrial morphology and did this via careful EM analysis. The first thing that you see here, the ultrastructure of mitochondria is intact, so they have normal cristae. So that seems to be okay. But what Tim noticed when he carefully evaluated all these electron micrographs, that there's a significant downshift of the size of mitochondria, indicative of mitochondrial fragmentation in the heart. And this is exactly what we would have expected, because we have shown before in cells, or many, actually several labs, I should say, have shown this before in cells, that if you take away YME1, you basically induce mitochondrial fragmentation. And it seems that the loss of YME1 is imposing a stress on mitochondria that activates the OMA1 peptidase, and by that shifts the balance to fusion and fission. So we see a mitochondrial fragmentation, and this we could also recapitulate in cardiomyocytes. You see here an aberrant mitochondrial morphology in this primary cardiomyocytes. And we did this because we wanted to look more biochemically, if you wish, at least directly look at the proteins in these cells. And this we could assess, does it affect mitochondrial activities, OPA1 processing in mitochondria. And for sure it does. And this is exactly the result that mirrors what I've shown you before in mouse embryonic fibroblasts. We delete YME1 in these three animals here. We lose the form D, which is basically generated by cleavage of OPA1 generating at S2. And we see some accumulation of form C and E, which is less pronounced, but we do see it, which are actually the forms that are generated by OMA1. Just here, this is another substrate of YME1, which is also accumulating just as a control here. So we see here exactly the same like a mouse embryonic fibroblast, loss of this YME1 form as expected, but also accumulation of these other forms that are generated by OMA1. Now this led us to hypothesize, and we have done this first in cells before we did it in the mouse, for time reasons, that the loss of YME1 may impose a kind of stress on mitochondria that activates this stress-induced peptidase, OMA1, and shifting the balance down to this C and E. This is now again in MEFs. You see here more C and E in these cells. Now these mitochondria are fragmented in MEFs and seemingly also in cardiomyocytes in vivo. But in MEFs, what we did is we looked in the double knockouts. And when we basically take this away, we take OMA1 from these cells away, we prevent the formation of these short forms and accumulate the long forms. And this resulted in tubulation of mitochondria. So from these cellular studies, we would think the cells fragment in the absence of YME1 because we activate the stress-induced processing by OMA1, of OPA1 by OMA1. So can we test this also in vivo? Here we basically generated double knockout MEFs and could restore mitochondrial morphology. Can we do this also in vivo? So for that, we basically, or Tim, took the heroic task to cross three alleles in one mouse, which you can do, but it takes time. Therefore, the cell culture work was definitely faster. So what he did is he crossed not only the conditional knockout or the floxed allele of YME1 with cardiomyocyte-specific Cre-line, but also introduced the floxed allele of OMA1 in this Cre-line. So he ended up with a double knockout cell that specifically lost YME1 and OMA1 specifically in cardiomyocytes only. So, and now what is the phenotype of these mice? Now, first of all, Western blot of these mice shows that there's really cardiomyocytes isolated from these mice, shows that there's the expected processing defect. We do not see any processing of OPA1 in these mice, which is nice. Also in vivo, YME1 and OMA1 are the only processing peptidases for OPA1. We see the accumulation of the YME1 substrate as expected. What about the heart function? And what about mitochondrial morphology? we do see a significant suppression of mitochondrial fragmentation in the heart. So this is the same analysis as I've shown you before. We just did EM, and then Tim carefully quantified basically the diameter or the mean surface of these mitochondria and looked at, plotted their distribution here. And as you can see here, when you look at the yellow versus the red one, the deletion of OMA1 in this YME1 knockout shifted the size of the mitochondria clearly to the larger side. I should say there's not restoring the size of mitochondria and wild type cells. So this is not the case, but we have a significant shift to the larger size, which is what we expected based on our cell culture work, because we prevent stress-induced processing by OMA1. Yeah? So we have an increase in size of the mitochondria. What about heart function? The heart is completely normal in these animals. This is just, again, a cardiography, echocardiography of these mice. And you see there is no significant difference. Moreover, without showing you, we have no signs of necrosis, fibrosis. The pumping rate of the heart is completely normal. So by deleting OMA1, we can completely suppress this dilated cardiomyopathy. Now this basically told us, just to wrap up this part, that the loss of YME1 basically activates OMA1. This results in stress-induced processing of OMA1. Mitochondrial fragmentation, which then results in chronic heart failure, which is associated with this metabolic shift from lipid metabolism to glucose metabolism. So this basically shows, first of all, that the loss of YME1 triggers the stress-induced processing of OMA1 and highlights the physiological relevance of the stress pathway, because it causes actually heart failure in this model, identifies that OMA1 is a critical regulator of cardiomyocyte survival, because if we inhibit OMA1 and take it away, cardiomyocytes live longer in this model, and therefore the heart is fine. It also shows, however, and there are some people who like it, others don't, that the long form of OPA1 seems to be sufficient for the survival in cardiomyocytes, seems to be sufficient for the survival of these animals. So we maybe don't need this processing at all. We are still breeding these mice. We're still doing a lifespan on these mice, so I want to see how long they really live. In a year from now, maybe I can tell you. But at the moment, it seems that they are really fine. Now, this is basically, we are played with this, and then we basically see. Now, this seems to be kind of a story. We could make sense out of it. But there was one observation that really puzzled us a lot, and this is shown here. So Tim, I mean, he was really an excellent postdoc. Now he has his own group. He basically crossed these floxed YME1 mice not only with a Cre deleter strain that specifically disrupted in cardiomyocytes, but he also used another Cre driver line, which basically deleted both in the skeletal muscle and in the heart. And I should say this is broadly used in the mitochondrial field to understand how muscle is affected in the biospecific intervention. Now, he did it. I actually asked him, why do we do the cardiomyocyte-specific one if you have the other one? He told me that this is better to do so, and if I ever saw that 3 years later. This is one of these experiments. I said it to someone today. This is a three-year experiment, basically, to get this curve, so I have to spend a bit of time on it. Anyway, it's just to highlight. So this is, again, the lifespan curve for this cardiomyocyte-specific one, and the lifespan curve of the other mice that lack it in cardiomyocytes, but in addition in skeletal muscle is completely fine. And here we did a full lifespan curve. So deleting YME1 in the skeletal muscle rescues or suppresses any effect that we see of a deletion of YME1 in the heart. This was completely unexpected and puzzled us a lot. As you can imagine, this is just, again, the Western blot just to convince ourselves that this is really the right mice we are looking at. So we have a specific deletion in the heart and in the muscle. Now, when we looked at the heart function in these animals was indeed fine. Expected it after seeing the lifespan. So there's everything fine, no sign of cardiomyopathy or anything. Even more surprising, when we look in the cardiomyocytes then, we do see mitochondrial fragmentation. So there is the phenotype in the cardiomyocytes seems, in terms of mitochondrial morphology, seems to be identical. So we have mitochondrial fragmentation in these mice, but still the mice are fine because they lack YME1 in the skeletal muscle. Really weird. So we were thinking what, so this is basically just a sign. So we have basically this mitochondrial fragmentation, which causes chronic heart failure, but an ablation of YME1 in the skeletal muscle renders these mice healthy. So what can this be? Now we thought a lot. One key issue seems to be this metabolic switch that is associated with the failing heart from glucose to fatty acid metabolism. And we were actually thinking about, so what is special about the skeletal muscle? Now, many people of you may be more familiar than this with, than I am, but of course, the skeletal muscle is an insulin signaling tissue, not the heart, but the skeletal muscle. So we were thinking, starting to think, could this be that there's an endocrine effect, perhaps via insulin signaling, that the deletion of YME1 in the skeletal muscle actually affects insulin secretion or insulin signaling, and in this way affects metabolism in cardiomyocytes, restoring or suppressing, cardiomyopathy in this mouse model. Now, we therefore did some glucose tolerance tests, and indeed it turned out that these mice lacking YME1 both in the heart and in the muscle show are glucose intolerant, and we see a reduced level of fasted animals, a reduced insulin level. So this is all consistent with this hypothesis that basically maybe insulin signaling affects the metabolism in the heart. I just added this here. These GTTs here show are also done in double knockout mice. We also generated double knockout mice lacking both YME1 and OMA1, both in skeletal muscle and cardiomyocytes, and this completely suppressed this phenotype. Because this glucose tolerance test shows that this systemic glucose intolerance in this HMYKO mouse is also caused by stress-induced OPA1 processing in the skeletal muscle in this case. But that's just a side thing. So the hypothesis is basically that by deletion of YME1, we basically impair insulin signaling, we render the cell, or we generate a systemic glucose intolerance, changing the metabolism in the cardiomyocytes and suppressing the cardiomyopathy in this YME1 specific mouse model. Now, can we prove this in another way? Now, another way to induce glucose intolerance is, of course, high fat diet. Never in my life I thought that we are doing these experiments in my lab, but here we did. So we put these mice on a high fat diet to basically induce a systemic glucose. And these mice, I should say, these are now the cardiomyocyte-specific mice. So these are the mice that show heart failure. So we put these mice on a high-fat diet, and you may think this is completely weird. I would join you in that. And then tested what effect does this have on the functioning of the heart in this mouse model. So first, basically, this is more or less a controlled experiment. We see systemic glucose intolerance in these mice, regardless whether YME1 is there or not. So these mice, you feed them with a high-fat diet, they gain weight, become fat, show this systemic glucose intolerance as you would expect it. It became more interesting when we basically looked at the glucose uptake in cardiomyocytes, because the high-fat diet indeed blunted the glucose uptake in these cardiomyocytes and actually also restored the acyl-carnitine levels in these mice. So this indicated to us that we indeed could shift the metabolism in these cardiomyocytes. Now, what about heart function? Now, it turns out that this high-fat diet completely restored heart function of these mice as long as we measured them. So we have a new therapy here, and this is just a joke. High-fat diet is good for against heart failure, and I was always in the lab, I was saying I will write some grant applications for that. I know some companies who should give me $1 million. These mice suffer of any deleterious effects of a high-fat diet. I'm just saying that. And sooner or later, they will die of, we had to stop the diet, of course, but they will die of obesity, obviously. So I'm not saying that, because, but in this time window, actually, it suppresses the failing heart in this mouse model. Actually, I don't show you that, but it even seems we are just doing that. It can even reverse the onset. If you start the high-fat diet after onset of the heart failure, we seem to be able to reserve it, but that's still very preliminary. Okay, and these are just some data to convince you that they really restore this heart function. There is basically, we have no signs of fibrosis in these mice. Necrotic cell death is gone, suppressed, and also the left ventricular injection volume of the heart is normal when we treat this mice with a high-fat diet. Now, what does it leave us with? This is just to wrap up what I just now told you, is the loss of VIMI-1 causes the stress-activated pathway. It activates OMA1, triggering mitochondrial fragmentation and resulting in a heart failure. And this can be, this heart failing heart can be, which occurs around one age, so mid-age mice, can actually be suppressed in two ways. Genetically, if we delete OMA1 and restore mitochondrial morphology. This prevents necrotic cell death, we believe, because it stabilizes mitochondria. OMA1 is a pro-apoptotic protein in this context, and basically prevents necrotic cell death and suppresses heart failure. However, we can also suppress this heart failure by a metabolic intervention that limits glucose uptake in the heart. Because this dilated cardiomyopathy caused by VIMI-1 deletion is associated with a metabolic change in cardiomyocytes. We see an increased glucose uptake and a decreased fatty acid oxidation. And if we interfere with this metabolism, either by high-fat diet or by deleting VIMI-1, the same gene in another tissue, and impairing insulin signaling, we can basically affect this metabolism and suppress heart failure independent of mitochondrial fragmentation. This, of course, suggests that this altered metabolism is somehow a downstream effect of mitochondrial fragmentation, but we don't understand it. That is something we were very much interested in, but we don't know really how this, what is behind this error, which seems so simple. Now, this is also, I think, a good example, coming back to the first part of my talk, that the stress-induced mitochondrial fragmentation is indeed physiologically relevant, and actually OMA1 may be an interesting target, because in the heart, when we activate OMA1, in this case by deletion of VIMI1, mitochondrial stress activates OMA1, this causes heart failure, and we can suppress it by OMA1. I also showed you at least one piece of data that when we activate OMA1 by deletion of VIMI1 in the skeletal muscle, this also impairs insulin signaling. So also there we have a consequence of a stress-induced mitochondrial fragmentation by OMA1. And we did another study that I don't have time to look into, where we looked actually in a mouse model where we specifically induce a dysfunction of mitochondria in the forebrain of the mouse by deleting another mitochondrial protein. I will say a bit more about it tomorrow. Prohibitins, which is a membrane scaffold, this triggers neurodegeneration. And in this case, when we delete OMA1 and prevent stress-induced processing, we significantly delay neuronal loss. We don't suppress it, but we delay neuronal loss. Also highlighting that also in neurons, this is a pathway that is really important for cell survival. Okay, now with this is basically the summary of what I've told you today. I hope I have introduced you to an important function of mitochondrial peptidases, in particular of OMA1. In the regulation of mitochondrial dynamics, the balance between fusion and fission. OMA1 and VIMI1 are both OPA1 processing peptidases, which ensure this balance of long and short form, balancing fusion and fission. OMA1 is a stress-activated peptidase that degrades the fusion-active form of OPA1, long OPA1, limits fusion, and also forms the short one, which we think is associated with fission. In that way, it shifts the balance between fusion and fission to the mitochondrial fragmentation, to the fission side, and mitochondrial fragmentation. Whereas fusion is considered to be a cell survival mechanism, mitochondrial fragmentation allows quality control, like autophagy, to occur. But we think in a persistent stress, this also renders the cells more susceptible to cell death. And this is what we look in this genetic model, like a VIMI1 deletion, which is, of course, a persistent stress that we impose on mitochondria. And therefore, we prevent the cell death by ablating of OMA1. But I don't want to, but I do think that under physiological conditions, OMA1 may actually be a quality control mechanism that is important here for autophagy. Now, with this, I'm at my end, and I really want to acknowledge the people in my lab. I really have had the pleasure over the years to have worked together with really many exciting and really absolutely outstanding co-workers in the lab. Now, this story that I told you was the mouse story was largely the work of a really outstanding postdoc in the lab, is Tim Wei. He has now his own group in Paris, and he really did all this heart-specific characterization of the consequences of a YMB1 deletion. Now his work, he also worked together with Ruchika before on the, you know, in the cell culture, did the cell culture work to understand the role of OPA1 processing. Michael looked together with Philip at the activation of OMA1. Anne's work I just briefly touched upon. She looked at OMA1 in the brain. And we have really great collaborations. In particular for this talk, I have to really highlight the collaboration of Boya Ibanez. That's one of the examples that you can do all the certain things that, frankly, I never thought that I'd look at an echocardiography in my lab, but we did, and I think it was a lot of fun. So they really helped us a lot and did many of the experiments, as I showed. And Pierre did Pierre Resto in Paris helped us with the oxygen measurements in the heart. And with Elena, we have looking at all the mouse models together since many years. Thank you very much. So in principle, the idea is that it's basically the question whether you fragment them, stress-induced or not. That's the idea. So if the stress is so strong that you basically depolarize them as a most extreme one, that you activate this peptidase, then you induce mitochondrial fragmentation. And then basically, if the stress persists, they remain fragmented. And basically, they are removed either by autophagy. And if then the stress persists even further, then you induce apoptosis. Huh? So you have to think of this as a kind of a gradual step. You basically elicit this response. You have fragmentation. And then if the stress is persistent, the cell tries constantly to refuse. But if the stress is persistent and OMA1 remains activated, you shift the balance constantly to the fragmented side. And if kinetically, if you basically stay longer on the fragmented side, you allow the autophagy machinery to basically being activated. And if worse comes to worse, you trigger cell death. So it's I think at the beginning, you have the activation of this pathway. And then there is a kinetic argument to it. That you basically, if you have it persistent, then you basically don't have it.
About self-division, mm-hmm. Fusion also happens.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, I should really emphasize there are different types of fission in the sense of the physiological output. So mitochondria fuse and divide all the time. This is not necessarily mediated by activation of OMA1. So OMA1 is under stress conditions. I should really say that. But you have normal fusion and fission events ongoing all the time in a cell. And under these conditions, you don't. It's basically not deleterious. So after fission event, I mean, there are experiments done by Urien Shirihai, and he basically looked kinetically. So each fission event is immediately followed by a fusion event. So the time that a mitochondria is fragmented is different. But this may be very different in different cell types and in different tissues. But in principle, you have this ongoing all the time. This is a pathway that is specifically activated in under stress conditions. For instance, we think that YME1 is a pathway where you basically shift this balance more, which may be more important under different various metabolic cues. So this is what I meant. There are different input signals that basically affect this rheostat and allow the adaptation to the different conditions. Well, so let's say these are metallopeptidases, and you can inhibit them with any metallopeptidase inhibitor. If you think of a treatment, it's not so helpful, first of all, because there are many metallopeptidases, and the main problem is to bring it there. Actually, we're trying to set up an assay to do a small molecule screen to look for inhibitors, in particular of OMA1, of the OMA1 peptidase, but they are not available at the moment, and it's not so trivial to reach the site there. Not that I'm aware of. So the question whether they are really, so we have no evidence for that.
The only way you turn
Yeah, is, I mean, that's the only thing we know. It's always better to answer like this. So there is actually no evidence we have that they really inhibit. In case of YME1, it's a bit more complicated because it's an ATP-dependent protease, and there, I think there are, we have some other assembly partners that affect the ATPase. But in terms of the OMA1 peptidase, which is really a classical metallopeptidase, we have no evidence for a physiological inhibitor. Yep. Yeah, this is a very important question, because one aspect of all what I've showed you in the second part in the mouse work also relies on the assumption that we are looking here at the same substrate under all conditions. And I have clearly to say we don't know. There are several arguments why I would argue we look at the same substrate, which is correlative, most importantly that these are the only substrate that we know where the both peptidases act. We actively look at other substrate of OMA1. There are one or two candidates, let's put it like this. They are all stress-regulated proteins. So in the literature, there's maybe one or two described, where I'm not so convinced about yet. But this is absolutely out there, and ongoing work is actually addressing that. There's one substrate that is established, I think, but this doesn't have anything to do with this pathway. But it's consistent with this being a stress-responsive peptidase. I don't know what was next. Can you speak up a bit? Sorry. Ah, in vitro, you mean? This we haven't really looked at, I must admit. This we haven't really looked at in vitro. I mean, of course, in vitro you have your cultured conditions where you impose the cell anyway under certain conditions. So you have to start somewhere. I'm not sure whether this is most informative under those conditions, but we haven't really looked whether they use then utilize in the presence of glucose maybe more lipids. This we haven't really looked. I think there was some. Yes, this is possible. This has been done by Kas Mihara's lab years ago. But they deleted 10 amino acids. You have to delete more because there seems not to be a cleavage specificity. And that would be the best in our model now to re-express this in these mice. There are two caveats. And I should say this has been done in a kidney disease where they basically rescued renal failure or suppressed renal failure by re-expressing this delta as OPA1. So this has been done in this physiological context. Here we have not. The critical thing why we haven't done it or even started it is that the expression level of OPA1 is very critical. So you need to adjust it very much. But otherwise, you have difficulties to distinguish between that. But there are these variants, and that will be, in terms in particular, what we said before, in terms of different substrates, something very valuable, absolutely. Yeah, please.
I thought it was really interesting that the fragmentation was like a shift in fuel utilization. Have you done whole body analysis of fuel switching, like passing to feeding and everything?
No, unfortunately not. You know, there are so many things now. No, we didn't go in this direction because, you know, we are not really not the, yeah, that's simply. Okay, Masu.
So, enhanced fusion and inhibit fusion will lead us the same. There are two ways to
distinguish. So, in the downstream effect should be the same, and there is no evidence that there is really a difference whether mitochondrial fragmentation is induced by increased fission or decreased fusion. However, there are quite different signaling cascades that impinge on these two pathways. So there are PKA-dependent pathways that are basically acting on fission, or the chunk-dependent pathways act on fission. So they act on the fission machinery at the outer surface, whereas this is a pathway that is basically, which impinges on fusion, that at the inner membrane. So what we think is that there are simply many different signaling cascades that impinge on this fusion and fission machinery, making it responsible to different input signals, and you have to always coordinate both inner and outer membrane. That makes it very complicated in the case of mitochondria because we have these two membranes there. But from the product, so to say, of the change in the morphology, there doesn't seem to be a difference. So that seems to be the same.
Okay, we're a little over time now, so let Thomas go. Please join us for reception.